Hello, hi, welcome back. It's great to be able to share. Thanks for subscribing and supporting. I hope I can help you to understand in these coming talks about how communism have influenced in the West and worldwide, and how we can fight back and bring victory over communism. Reverend Sean Moon, the youngest son of Reverend Sun Myung Moon, calls communism political Satanism. In 1980, Reverend Sun Myung Moon called for a worldwide ideological offensive to counteract the global threat of communism. He called it VOC, or Victory Over Communism, and Causa. Okay, let me tell a little bit about where I come from. I grew up in Denmark in the 60s and 70s. It's a small country with supposedly some of the happiest people in the world. Danes are very friendly and kind and very proud of being Danes, but they need to learn more about God. But so much socialism in Denmark. You have social health care, the retirement is paid for, elderly care, help with rent if you have a big family or limited income. You even get child support. You get paid each month for each of your children, all paid by the government. But where does it come from? It comes from the high income tax, which is minimum 55%. Many have a higher. So it's like tax farming in Denmark. Denmark is part of EU, so same rules as the rest of Europe, like for instance for farming. My dad was a farmer and my sister's husband is a farmer. And he said, like, one example is you cannot farm on steep hills, because they're thinking of the Swiss mountains. They are thousands of feet tall and they're afraid of erosion, whereas the tallest mountain in Denmark is 300 feet. We have many small hills, so we need to farm them and use them. Okay, I grew up in Denmark. I was young. I was foolish. I was triggered to believe that communism was for peace, equality, and cooperation. One of my friends even had pictures, like movie star pictures, of Fidel Castro and Che Guevara, like movie stars, on her wall. I did not know who they were. It was another thing that was really important. It was not in to go to church. Only old people go to church at that time. So the moral standard was falling a lot. There was a lot of drinking. The young people would have girlfriends, boyfriends. And when you look at, like, the government in Denmark, there was, like, many parties. There still is many parties. They were very leftist, mostly leftist parties. And there even was a small communist party, openly communist. And they gave so many false promises. Even from Russia, Khrushchev came to visit Denmark in the 60s to share about communion farming. Such a flop. But they spoke it up like so amazing and made beautiful brochures with happy farmers and factory workers. They also talked about the unions, and that's when all the unions started in Denmark. In school, you could choose between Russian or French as your fourth language in high school. It's a small country, so everyone learned Danish, English, and German. We're only 5 million people, so we have to be able to speak to people in the rest of the world. And when I look at, like, my history teacher, he was a communist, and we had to read and study the Communist Manifesto. I hated it, but I didn't really know why. It just didn't make sense. So when I met Reverend Moon, that helped me to understand what was happening. It was communist propaganda to make the whole world communist, promising utopia and peace. And the problem in Denmark was that the Judeo-Christian foundation was so weak and ignorant. The church is even under the government. You pay like 1% of your income tax goes to the Danish National Lutheran Church. It pays for the priest's wages, and also pays, you don't give donations, you don't tithe, you just pay your income tax for the church. And also, it's not, you don't talk about politics, you know, and you don't talk about religion with each other. You just talk about the things that are easy to talk about. And if you look at the families, most of the families, both parents work. So the children go first to baby daycare and so on, and then later to school, and the government is raising the children, just like in China, just like it was in Russia and other communist countries. Even in communist countries, the children spy on their parents and report to the teachers. And the parents might end up in prison camp. The whole family might end up in prison camp. There is so many prison camps in China. There was in Russia, it was a gulag. And they try to break down the family, God's cornerstone for the society. Today, on top of that, there are so many Muslim immigrants that is coming into Europe. It's like an invasion, but I'll talk more about that later. So Reverend Sam Yung Moon started CAUSA to counteract communism in the 80s, 1980. And some of the coming words that I'm speaking is from the book Introduction to the CAUSA Worldview by Reverend Sam Yung Moon that was published in 1984. Okay, so when at the conclusion of World War II, the Allied forces confirmed the rumors about Dachau and Auschwitz, the world was appalled. 6 million men, women and children had been herded like animals to their deaths. Their only crime was that they were not members of Hitler's elite chosen race. Adolf Hitler had advocated the building of a new society. He had called on the Aryan race to build the Third Reich. The Reich's leadership was to have been the guiding light for all civilization. The promise of a new society became the justification to murder millions and plunge the world into war. Today the world is outraged by Hitler's barbarism. Yet apparently we have not learned our lesson. The era of the free world 80 years ago was apathy and indifference. When Hitler said, "German wants nothing but peace and therefore knows no imperialistic policy of conquest toward the outside," we just believed him. When the rumors about the extermination of the Jewish people were officially denied, we believed him again. Today again, we risk making that same error. A new self-proclaimed elite has emerged. It speaks of establishing a civilization devoid of war, racism, and hunger. It promises utopia, workers' paradise, the long-awaited ideal society on earth. This is international communism. Its proponents cite the writings of Karl Marx as the basis of their belief. 170 years have passed since Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels wrote the Communist Manifesto. 101 years have gone by since the first communist government was established in Russia. Communism promised the attainment of the true and ultimate human dignity, but the record of the past 101 years of communism is a history of brutal and demeaning acts of man against man. Nowhere are human beings more degraded than under communist rule. In fact, there is no foundation in the communist philosophy for an understanding of human rights and dignity. Communist slogans boast of a concern for these, but once power has been seized, the slogans are abandoned, and the state rules absolutely. When people come to realize that they have walked into a trap, it's already too late. That's what happened in Venezuela recently. Communism promised a society of material satisfaction for all. Impoverished people have been particularly drawn by guarantees of food, land, ownership of the means of production, industries, and control of resources. Many thought that even a high degree of sacrifice would be justified for the sake of following generations. Contrary to the promises, however, communism has starved millions to death and deprived unknown multitudes of every shred of personal possession, often driving them far away from their homelands, indicating perhaps symbolic of the poverty of the Soviet state in 1984 is the fact that every Soviet housewife at that time spent an average of 20% of her leisure time queuing up for basic commodities, primarily food and clothing. I went to Latvia in 1992 after the Berlin Wall came down. Even then, after the Berlin Wall came down, there was very little in the grocery stores. One day we could get bread, and there was only one kind of bread. Another day you could get meat and vegetables. And the vegetables were very scarce and sometimes a bit rotten too. Plus the city in Latvia looked just like Western Europe 100 years ago. They lost 100 years. Since 1960 to 1990, the life expectancy of the Soviet male had decreased from 67 to 62, while during the same period in Japan, it increased from 70 to 75. From 60 to 84, the infant mortality rate in the USSR has nearly doubled from 23 per 1,000 births to 40 per 1,000 births, nearly four times the US rate. Communism promised a classless society where the equality of men would be perfected and the exploitation of one class by another would cease. Sadly, it's in the communist societies there's entirely new type of super elite has entrenched itself in a position of absolute supremacy over all facets of life. Those who fled Soviet Russia described it as the world's largest prison camp. For the overwhelming majority of the camp's detainees, escape is impossible. Hundreds of millions were serving an indefinite term with no hope of a pardon. So what's the human cost of communism? According to Il Figaro, November 18, 1978, is 150 million deaths. And out of them, 70 million was from Soviet Union, 65 million from China, 3 million from Cambodia, and other 10 million, and it is even more now. On top of this, more than 330 million induced abortions have been carried out in China since the one-child policy was implemented in the early 1980s. Many couples were pressured or even forced into having abortion so they would not violate the policy. Some families chose to abort female fetuses in order to have a son, resulting in a heavily skewed sex ratio. This is from inkstonenews.com. Now we have good news in Eastern Europe. At least the Berlin Wall came down in the 1989, and Eastern Europe is free. Everyone is free to travel again. Amazing at great. But many other countries are still under communism, like China, North Korea, Cambodia, many others. Let us keep fighting for freedom and really protecting the Second Amendment rights in America. May His kingdom come. God bless you. Have a great day. And I'll share more about what happened under communism in the next few talks. Thank you so much.